He'll use our arms to hug a woman that just needs love in order to make a difference. And he'll call us to a park to use us to make a difference. I'm so glad that I didn't listen to my flesh yesterday. The love that I have in my heart for my wife is one of the deepest loves that I've ever known. I can't say that I love her more than anything or anyone, because my love for the Lord runs all the way into my soul. But as people, I don't know that I have a deeper love for any other person than what I have for my wife. And I've watched her all week long struggle just to walk through the house or to step outside in the yard or run to pick up a grandchild or something of that nature. And she grimaces and she's crying this week, the pain that she's in. But you know, Laura, she's got such a soft, sweet, kind heart that she just does what she does. And for the most part, this week she's just laid in bed, taking medicine, and trying to go to sleep. And this is our busy season, so I will probably 3 out of 5 days this week, I didn't even make it home from work till 9:30 at night. Get up at 4 o'clock and start it all over again. I've been absent. When I'm there, I'm there. But we're in the busy season. And so yesterday was Saturday. And I didn't have to work. And I woke up and I knew that I'd been asked to go to the city park to sing a few songs, but they wanted me to be the preacher that showed up and preached the message. And it was a beautiful day in the park. If you were there, you know what I'm talking about. There were people there that were testifying of how Jesus has made a difference in their life. And there were people there that were singing good old-fashioned gospel songs about how Jesus makes a difference And the Lord called me to preach, and it was just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful day. And I remember at one point thinking, I'm just not going to go. You know, there's going to be so many people there that are going to share their testimonies. There's going to be so much singing. Will I really be missed? And I started to justify it because, Lord, I've been absent from home most of the week because of work. This is Saturday, and I'm not expected to go in and drive a truck or deliver steel. This is my day off. I remember praying, Lord, I don't want to sound ungrateful, and I'm not whining and I'm not crying, Lord, but I only ever get one day off. Sunday's not a day off for me, Lord. You know, Sunday is not Sunday. It's one of my busiest days. Most people really get a chance to rest and take a day off on Saturday or a day off on Sunday. They show up for work just refreshed. And I show up on Monday just tired, Lord, because Sunday's not a day off for me. Saturday is the only day off, Lord. And Laura's been struggling all week long, and I'm going to stay home today, and I'm going to cook for her, and I'm going to do some laundry, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that. And I felt a conviction hit my heart, an urgency. It wasn't necessarily a conviction. I felt a sense of urgency hit my heart. It's like I heard the Lord say, I love you for loving her. She's going to be all right. She's in my hands. I need you to go to the park. So I went. And I'm so glad that I did. The fellowship was wonderful, Brother Brent, wasn't it wonderful? Amen. The fellowship. fellowship was wonderful. There was food for everyone. Whether you brought something or whether you didn't, if you needed something to eat, if you needed something to drink, there was plenty of food. There was plenty of stuff to drink. There were so many singers that showed up, and they were all singing to the glory of the Lord, and the power of the Holy Spirit began to fall. And we were in the city park in Rochester, at the city park. There were families there, kids running around and playing. And this was all amplified. It was through a sound system. And you could hear what was happening at that tent revival, is what I'm going to call it. It was blasting across the park. And just people who were just showing up, but not even knowing that there was an event taking place there, they wound up hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ in so many different ways.
Amen.
And I remember sitting there thinking as the people that were there stand up and begin to testify about how Jesus made a difference in their life and the world that they were living in before they came to Christ, and how torn up and broken their lives were. And I remember one woman's testimony in particular. All of the testimonies were powerful. I'm not saying that, but there was one woman's testimony that really stood out to me. She looked to be an older woman. I mean, an elderly woman, but I'm guessing she was probably somewhere my age. I might be getting older. I'm not elderly yet. I'm not ready for a rocking chair. But she looked like she had scars. I'll put it that way. She had visible scars, and I'm not talking about the kind where she had gotten cut and had to be stitched up. I'm talking about life scars. This woman was scarred. And when she began to talk, she couldn't even hardly talk because her voice was so rough. It was due to the lifestyle that she had lived before. And she began to testify about how strong her addictions were in her life. And she began to talk about how that she just ate hundreds of pills a day. Most of them were, and I don't really know what to call them, but she was calling them speed. And she said that she would mix them with diet pills so that she would get a greater effect of the drug. And she said, literally, I ate hundreds of them a day. Then, on to top that off, she would chase them down with whiskey, and her life was just destroyed. She testified to the fact that her children wound up losing all respect for her and all love for her. You really had to listen close to her because she didn't have much of a voice left any longer. Her throat, her body had just been destroyed from years and years and years of abuse with alcohol and pills. She really talked gruff. She began to tell us how, one by one, she lost her children, that they no longer loved her, didn't have anything to do with it any longer. She told them a story where she had lied to her husband. She told her husband she was no longer using. But he didn't believe her. And he confronted her one day. And she swore, "You're wrong, I'm no longer using." She said he went to the freezer and he pulled out a freezer-sized bag. And the bag was full of those pills. And he said, "If you're no longer using, then you won't care that I'm going to do what I'm about to do." And he opened up the back door. He threw the pills out in the grass. She said she dove through the door into the yard. And she was grabbing handfuls of pills. And as she would grab handfuls of pills, dirt and grass would be in her hand with them. And she was stuffing them in her mouth. And she said she had a mouthful of pills and a mouthful of dirt and a mouthful of grass. And she was crying and she was weeping. She just needed help, but she didn't know. That's the day her husband left her. And she's all alone. No family. Divorced. He's remarried. Children no longer have anything to do with her. She said she tried to commit suicide, but she even failed at that. But then she spoke about someone that came and shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with her. And if I heard her right, because again, it was very hard to understand what she was saying. But if I heard her right, the person that came to share Jesus Christ with her, she told him, I'm not worthy of this. Just take it to someone else. There's no way the Lord loves me like that. And this person told her, for God so loved the world that he gave. He said, that's what love does, ma'am. It gives. And I believe the Lord called me here today so that he could give you hope through me. She said that changed everything for her. And I can't remember now what she said, because again, she was hard to understand. But I'm thinking she said, now that she was 7 years sober and 7 years clean, and that she still misses her family, but she, for the first time in her life, she no longer feels alone. I got to admit to you, when I got to the park, I looked around and I saw all of the people that were there, and there was something on the inside of me that got excited. Because what I was seeing, oh, forgive me, Lord. What I was seeing was people that I felt really needed to hear a salvation message. And I said, Lord, use me. And I started looking around, and I saw Judy, and I saw Rose Bellamy was there, and I saw Britt and Pat, they were there. There was a handful of others from the church that was there. And I remember thinking to myself, boy, I really wish that the churches would get behind this kind of stuff. They don't know what they're missing. I remember thinking that, you know, we testify to the fact that this world needs Jesus. And Jesus is in us. Where we walk, he goes. Where we speak, he speaks. And I remember thinking to myself, I just speak it out loud, I remember thinking to myself, oh, the church as a whole, and I'm not just talking about the two churches that I pastor, I'm talking about the church as a whole. You get on Facebook and you can see where people will say it's time that the church stand. You can get on social media and you can see posts where somebody's saying that we need to make a difference in the world. And I remember sitting there looking around, and what I'm seeing is a rough-looking crowd. And in my heart, I'm thinking, these folks need to be saved. And in my mind, I'm thinking, our church world today says one thing, but when they have a chance to do another, they don't come through within the Lord, but because I myself was trying to justify the fact that I should just stay home. And I said, Lord, forgive. One by one, that crowd that needs Jesus, stood up and began to testify about how Jesus has made a difference in their life. And I thought to myself right then and there, which is part of what I was feeling here in this pew, Lord, don't ever let me take my call for granted. Jesus makes a difference.
Yes.
Has Jesus made a difference in your life? He's made a difference in mine. I remember thinking how Jesus makes a difference And I remembered my life before Christ. And I couldn't help but think that I could have been one of those ones that showed up in the city park in Rochester, Indiana, to stand up looking as rough as a piece of sandpaper with a testimony of how God, how Jesus made a difference in my life. Even if the preacher that was there to deliver a message of hope thought within himself, this man needs Christ. You want to talk about feeling small? And I just started praising the Lord, and the Holy Spirit moved, and the singing was wonderful, and the testimonies was wonderful. And when I stood up to preach, I haven't preached that. Maybe I have, but I haven't felt that I've preached that powerful in a long, long time. And the Lord was honored, and the Lord was glorified, and people were praying, and what a wonderful, wonderful time it was. I remember all the way through that thinking to myself, and I knew when I was thinking it, because the thought kept coming to me, I knew when I was thinking it that the Lord was building a message in me, and the message is that Jesus makes a difference. When I got in the car to go home, the radio was playing, and I wasn't really paying much attention to this, this background noise, but I was praising the Lord for the day that was there. And for the mighty move of the Holy Spirit that was there, for the people that got fed, not just food, but spiritual food and everything. I was just lost in praise as I was going down the road. And automatically the Lord just got my attention and said, pay attention to this song. It was a country song. It wasn't even a gospel song. It wasn't even on a Christian station. It was Willie's Roadhouse, if you want to know what it was, on Sirius Radio. I like country music, but I can't really stand the newer stuff, so I listen to the old stuff. The old stuff is the better stuff. I had it on Willie's Roadhouse, and as I'm praising the Lord, not paying any attention to the background music, I'm just praising the Lord. It's like the Lord said, shh, stop, and just listen, I'm still talking to you. And you want to know what I heard? Oh, if I ever had confirmation of a message in my life, I heard it then and there. You want to know what I heard? I heard Ronnie Millsap. How many of you know who Ronnie Millsap is? I heard Ronnie Millsap singing, what a difference you made in my life. Have you heard the song? What a difference you've made.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah, you know what it hurts sometimes? It's going to happen. You're not going to make it through this world without hurt. Amen. You're not going to make it through this world without being confused. You're not going to make it through this world without getting angry. Without feeling frustrated.
Amen.
Without feeling fear. It's not going to happen. You're in the flesh. Yes, you're full of the Holy Spirit, but you're walking around in a fleshly body. And the Bible teaches us that on a daily basis, the flesh wars against the Spirit wars against the flesh. You're not going to make it through this life without feeling pain, without feeling frustration, without understanding. Not understanding some stuff. It's going to happen. Folks are going to get sick. You're going to lose loved ones. There's hardships and there's troubles and there's trials, but guess what? Jesus makes a difference. Amen?
Amen.
That's why he came.
Yes.
That's why he came. To be the difference that makes a difference. And he's calling us to do the same. Read with me, if you will. I'm in John chapter 6. I'm going to start reading at verse number 1. We're going to go through, I don't know, 13 or 14 verses. Probably 14. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Brother Mark, testified to a dream. I want you to pay attention. And a great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles which he did on them that were diseased. They saw the miracles. Sometimes we just long to see a miracle, don't we?
Yeah.
You know, the Lord is doing miracles every day that we live.
Amen.
Every day.
Amen.
We just aren't seeing them, honestly, because we stopped looking for them. But the Lord is always working miracles. And Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. I am so glad to know it doesn't matter if we're on the mountaintop or if we're in the valley, Jesus sits down with us.
Yes, he does.
And he makes a difference in our lives. He's caused me to understand some things just this morning that I have struggled with for years and years and years. Some things have just come crystal clear to me today. And it's all because the Lord took a little bit of time to sit down with this disciple. When Jesus then had lifted his eyes and he saw a great company coming to him, he saith unto Philip, whence shall we buy bread? Or in other words, where can we go to buy some bread that these people may eat? And this he said, look at verse number 6. See, this popped out to me this morning. This he said to prove him. I looked at another translation and it said, this he said to prove to him. Sometimes the Lord needs to prove some stuff to us, doesn't he? He needed to prove something to Philip. Why? Well, what's the second half of verse 6 say? For he himself knew what he would do. Say this with me. Jesus already knows what to do.
Jesus already knows what to do.
Hey, man, don't that bless somebody in here? Somebody in here, somebody watching over the internet right now, you're sitting here thinking, I don't know what to do. Listen, Jesus already knows what to do.
Amen.
Don't let yourself get overcome with fear or worry or doubt or dread. Jesus, like you might not know what to do. Listen, our minds are not infinite. And there's no way that we're going to understand and know everything that Christ understands and knows. And it's come to me that if I don't know what to do, and trust me, that happens a lot. If I don't know what to do, it's okay. All I got to do is put my little hand in Jesus' big hand and let him lead me because he already knows what to do.
That's right.
All I got to do is trust him, though.
That's right.
Amen. We're at verse number 7. Philip answered him, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them. That was a big group of people. That every one of them may take a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said unto him, well, there is a lad here which has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many? Can I tell you something? Jesus will never use what you don't have. That's profound. Let that sink in. Jesus will never use what you don't have. But whatever you do have, no matter how small or insignificant it might seem to you, he'll use that to bless multitudes. That woman that you met, the Lord's going to use her. That woman that I was talking about in the park, that woman is being used by the Lord. It doesn't matter who you are, where you came from, how much or how little you have. I really wish all these money-hungry, greedy preachers that are filling up our cable TV channels and radio stations would just sit down for a minute and read that verse of Scripture. It don't matter how much or little you have. Jesus will never use what you don't have, but what you do have, He'll use. And you have something to offer. You have Christ in you. Yes. Amen. Yes. Oh, who am I? I'm just one person. What can I do? What can I possibly accomplish? I don't have nothing to offer. Do you have Christ? If the answer to that question is yes, you have value today. And you have something to offer. And this world needs it. Amen. Let Jesus use you. Boy, I sure hope Pastor Thad is on fire today. I sure hope that he's tuned into the Holy Spirit. I'm ready for a good old-fashioned barn burner. But what if Pastor Thad is off on vacation? I sure hope Brother Mark, I hope he steps up to the pulpit and just yields himself to the Holy Spirit. Can I promise you something? And I'm not saying this out of pride. You know me, I'm a humble man. You got two preachers in here that will not stand up and speak until we humble ourselves under the Holy Spirit's God. This ain't about Mark. Amen. It ain't about that. This is about Jesus, because we can't do anything. Jesus makes the difference.
Amen.
But why? Why don't we understand? You know what? I would love, I want to say this, and I don't want you to form a pulpit committee at the end of the service and say, well, he must be done. Because, no, I love you, and I'm going to stay here until the trumpet sounds or until you kick me out. How's that? So I hope that you can hear what it is that I'm about to say. I would love to preach me right out of a position. Mm-hmm. I would. I wish that I could cover the Word of God and teach it to you and preach it to you in such a powerful, simple way that you no longer need a Thad or a Mark to stand up here and expound upon the Word of God for you, because you already have it in such a way that you know that you, every one of you, can raise up and be a preacher or a teacher or a minister in your own right. I would love to be able to preach myself right out of a position. That's what I would love to do. Why? It's not because I'm tired of it. Why? It's not because I dislike it. You know me, I can do it. I have to watch the clock here, or you guys will be here at 3 o'clock. I love to preach. So why would I make such a statement? Because I love you. And you, 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 and all the others that ain't even here. I love you. And I want to feed you.
Yes.
To the point where the only reason I'm here is because you love me back and we're fellowshipping and I get to use my call to preach and teach. But if I could preach you to the point where you no longer needed to hear my voice, I could leave this world shouting hallelujah. Friend, you've got something to offer. I don't care if you're single and living at home by yourself, or if you're married with a house full of barefoot kids. You're important. You have value to the Lord. This little boy, how insignificant do you think this little boy was? They didn't give him a name. And then they said, hey, yeah, there's a lad down here. There's a little boy out here. I don't even know whose kid he is. You better run him around here having all kinds of fun. He's got a little paper sack in his hand, and in that paper sack there's a couple of fish and some 5 small loaves of barley bread. But what in the world is that going to do? I guess the little boy can sit down and eat lunch. I'm getting kind of hungry. Hopefully he lets me bite a piece of that bread and Jesus took what that little insignificant boy had, and he blessed it, and he fed a multitude of people. We've preached this 7 times to Sunday. I'm not going to sit down and rest on that, but it came to me when Mark gave his testimony about his dream. I thought, you can't even make this up. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said unto him, "There is a lad here which has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many?" And Jesus said, "Make the men sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in the number of about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves. When he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were set down, and likewise of the fishes as much as they would. I'm so glad for Jesus. I'm not taking nothing away from that, but I am so glad for the disciples who were willing to be used of Christ to bless someone else. Not just in this verse of Scripture, but in my life. In my life. I am so glad for every preacher. I'm so glad for every teacher, for every pastor, for every evangelist, for every time I got drunk in church and heard a message. Because it brought forth the truth. And I'm saved today because of Jesus. But because Jesus laid a call on somebody else's heart to share the gospel. Amen? Somebody once said, "Pastor, there's a song out there, and every time I hear it, it makes me think of you." And I said, "What song is it?" And they said, "It's a song that's called Thank You. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that has changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I'm so glad you gave it." And that really blessed me. But you want to know something? There's folks up in heaven that I'm going to be able to look up and say, "Hey, I just want to thank you because I'm a life that was changed and the Lord used you." You want to know something else? That's not just the preacher's job. That's not just the pastor's job.
Amen.
It's not just for the singers. That's not just Michaela's job. She's the music guru at the church, and that's what she's supposed to do. She goes to heaven. Someone's going to look at her and say, "Thank you for it." It's not just Michaela. It's not just that. It's not just Mark. It's not just the preacher's job. It's not just the teacher's job. It's all of us. Amen. It's all of us. It's for those of you that are willing to go to work in a laundromat and be Jesus for somebody. It's for all of you that are willing to go to work in a school or in a factory or when you own your own business. For those of you that are willing to be a grandfather or a grandmother. It's for husbands, it's for wives, it's for moms, it's for dads, it's for brothers, it's for sisters, it's for neighbors. When you go into a doctor's office and you wind up being an encouragement to the doctors and the nurses that are working on you, it's for all of us. It's for all of us. Christ can do anything, and He does everything. But stop for a moment and realize when Christ was here on this earth in the flesh, He walked Himself wherever He needed to go. If someone was sick, He touched whoever needed to be touched.
Amen.
When someone needed a word, He spoke whatever word needed to be spoken. Christ stepped out on a cloud of glory and ascended back up into the heavens where He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And He said, "I will not leave you comfortless. I will send another comforter, the Holy Spirit." Christ has sent the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit lives and dwells on the inside of every born-again believer. So up and put back down, and then you feel this one stand up and put back down, and this one stand up and put back down. When Christ needs to walk now, he uses your feet. When Christ needs to touch now, he uses your hands. When Christ needs to speak now, he uses your tongue. Hear me today, church. We are the body of Jesus Christ. The church isn't just a beautiful little hall. The church isn't just a beautiful little sanctuary. This is a building. And it's nothing more than a building. I love this building, and it means something to me. This is where we gather to worship. This is where we gather to praise. This is where the Lord has chosen to bless his people. But make no mistake, we're in tornado season. We could be the next one in line to show up with skid loaders and dump trucks to try to clean this place up. If that happens, the church is not destroyed, because you are the church. This building is a building. We're the body of Christ.
Yes.
And if someone in your world needs someone to walk with them, let Jesus use your feet. Mm-hmm. If someone in your world needs Jesus to speak with them, let Jesus use your tongue. If someone in your world needs Jesus to hug them, let Jesus use your arms. And that's what I see. That's what I see. When they were filled, verse 12, when they were filled, he said unto his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. Therefore they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which remained over and above unto them that had eaten. And I know I've taught this to you before, but I'm just going to mention it. I won't spend 5 minutes preaching it, but I want to reiterate something here. How many disciples were there?
12.
How many?
12. More.
How many baskets were taken up?
12.
You know what? Jesus cares about you too. Sometimes we can feel tired. Sometimes we can feel beaten. And sometimes we wonder, when is it our turn? Stop thinking that way. Everything that you go through has a purpose. And that purpose is so that you understand when you reach out to someone else what they're feeling and what they're experiencing. And if you didn't understand that, then you wouldn't be able to help them. So when the scripture says to rejoice in our sufferings and praise God in our trials, the word is wise. And if we could just learn to rejoice in those things, understanding that they are working for our good, so that we can be used of the Lord to minister to somebody else, then we come to understand that you're not just pouring yourself out and people are just ended up. You got a whole basket full for yourself. The Lord's going to take care of you. Say that with me. The Lord's going to take care of you.
The Lord's going to take care of you.
Amen. Isn't Jesus good to us?
Yes.
Amen. 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 Then those men, look at verse 14. Then those men, when they had seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, this is of a truth that prophet that should come to the world. Oh, isn't that a beautiful saying in the Bible? I could just relive this over and over and over and over again. This is one of my favorite reads. Because I allow my imagination to work, and I oftentimes put myself in the scene. Sometimes I'm one of the hungry ones that need to be fed. How many of you have ever just felt hungry and you need to be fed?
Yes.
Sometimes I'm one of the disciples that is just working to feed everybody. How many of you ever felt like the disciple that's just working and working and working and working? Amen? It doesn't matter who you try to. Sometimes I feel like the little boy. Just small, insignificant. And I don't have a whole lot to offer, but Time and time and time and time again, I see the Lord use what I do have and bless it and help other people. I can identify with a lot of people in the scene here in the scripture. It's one of the reasons why it's one of my favorites. And I don't know how you identify, but I hope that you try. And I want to tell you today that Jesus makes the difference. Jesus makes the difference because of his power. Take a look at verses 1 and 2 again. Well, just take a look at verse 2. And a great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles which he did on them that were diseased. They saw Jesus at one point in time heal sick people. And it was such a powerful miracle that it made an impact on their life. And because it made an impact on their life, they started following Christ for themselves. I'm so glad for the ones that are in my life and for those that were in your life. And I'm so glad for you who are making an impact on the life of someone else. It's causing them to follow your Jesus. Amen? And if you follow Jesus long enough, he's going to reveal himself to you. And you're going to get humbled, and you're going to get convicted, and you're going to get drawn. And when you get drawn, your heart's going to open up. You'll repent, you'll cry, you'll ask for forgiveness, and you too will become a born-again child of God. Praise the Lord for his power. Jesus has the power, amen, to heal the sick. Jesus has the power to calm the storm. Jesus has the power to raise the dead and to cast out demons. And Matthew 28, 18 says, and Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all power in heaven and in earth is given unto me.
Yes.
Amen. Jesus makes the difference in your life because he has the power to do so.
Yeah.
I'm thankful for the power of the Lord today. Praise his holy name. Folks, you've tried everything else under the sun. Now, give it to Jesus because he has the power to do things for you. Things that nobody else can do. Jesus makes the difference because of his knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Take a look specifically at verse number 6. Verse number 6 says this, and this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. Jesus makes the difference because of his knowledge. He already knows what to do. Listen, at the marriage feast in Cana, when they didn't have any wine, Jesus knew what to do. He said, take those 6 water pots, bring them up here to me, fill them up with water, fill them to the brim. And they filled them up to the brim. And then he said, now take it and give it to the governor of the feast. And they gave it to the governor of the feast. And when the governor of the feast had drank it, he had to praise because that was the best wine that he had ever had in his life. When they didn't have any wine at the marriage feast of Cana, say this with me, Jesus knew what to do.
Jesus knew.
When the disciples didn't have the money to pay their tax, he told them to go down to the sea, cast in a hook, and the very first fish that bites that hook, bring it in, open up its mouth, reach your hand out inside there, and pull out a coin and go pay the tax. Say this with me, Jesus already knew what to do.
Jesus already knew.
Amen. And in today's message, he already knew what to do. Jesus is a problem solver, folks.
Yes.
Amen. He knows what to do and he knows how to do it. If you have a problem in your life today and you don't know what to do, give it to Jesus because Jesus already knows what to do. Say this with me, Jesus is a problem solver.
Jesus is a problem solver.
If you have problems in your life, and I'm not just talking about sin problems, if you've got a sin problem in your life, you need to seek Jesus Christ. Because he said in his word, if you die in your sin, learn of him, there you cannot come. Sin is the biggest problem that faces mankind in our world today. It's not nuclear war. It's not trouble in the Middle East. It ain't got nothing to do with any man's greatest need is salvation from their sin.
Yes.
So if you're here today, or you're watching over the internet, and you've not repented of your sin, well, wait a minute, preacher. Are you one of them judgmental guys? Don't you know the Bible says everyone has sinned, falls short of the glory of God? You ain't all that in a box of Cracker Jacks. Are you trying to tell me you never sinned? No. No, and you can't say that neither. Everybody's going to commit a sin. Do you want to know something? There's some folks that commit sin, and there's other folks that are committed to it. If you're committed to living a sinful lifestyle, you are lost and need to be saved. And if that's you today, Jesus can remedy your sin problem. He's already done it when he bled and died on an old rugged cross outside of Jerusalem on top of a hill called Mount Calvary. When he shed his blood, we sing that song, there's power in the blood. Amen. When he shed that powerful blood, if you fall underneath its life-giving stream and get washed clean from your sin and let the Holy Spirit fill you, you're still going to have problems, you're still going to have struggles, you're still going to get it wrong, you're still going to commit a sin. I'm not going to stand up here and preach to you something that ain't true. It's still going to happen. But the difference is you got something in you that you didn't have before. And it'll make you feel guilty. It'll make you feel sorry for what you've done. It'll drive you to your knees until you cry out to the Lord and say, Lord, forgive me. Man, I can't believe that was me that did that. I can't believe that was me that said that. Forgive me. Strengthen me. I'm not going to do it no more. Amen. But a person that's committed to sin, don't think that way. If you're committed to sin, well, what? Yeah. I believe in preaching an old-fashioned message. And if you're going to preach an old-fashioned message, you've got to get back to preaching against sin. Our world is running wild today, based upon their flesh.
Yes.
Whatever they want, they're going to do. Whatever. It's all about me, 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 me. And I'm just going to tell you, that's prideful and it's sin. And if you're lost in your sin and you're committed to that, I love you. Whether you believe it or whether you don't, whether you love me for it or whether you hate me for it, I love you. And I love you enough to tell you the truth. That's a problem. And man's biggest problem in this world isn't with the economy. It isn't with Democrats in the White House. I'm sorry, but it's not. It's not if Trump's going to run for president. I'm sorry, but it's not. It ain't a cure for cancer. It ain't troubles in the Middle East. Man's biggest problem is with sin. And yeah. Jesus makes that difference.
Yes.
He already knew what to do. Jesus makes a difference because of his ability. Did you see in verses 7 through 13 that he had the ability to work such a miracle? Amen. He took that little boy's lunch and blessed it and broke it, and 5,000 men got fed. And there was even leftovers. Enough for each one of the disciples. That's a miracle. Christ had the ability to do that. You want to know what? Christ has the ability to work miracles in our lives today too. He does. And he works them every day. The scripture teaches us in the book of Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 6 that he who would come to him must believe that he is.
Yeah.
That he is what?
That he is.
That he is the Lord. That he's God in flesh.
Amen.
That he's the creator of life. that he's the source of joy, that he heals, that he delivers, that he forgives, that he restores. You must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Oh, we seek a lot of things diligently today. But what is our prayer life? What's it look like? Well, preacher, I spend about, you know, I pray three times a day, preacher. Yay! Yay! How many minutes in prayer is that equate? Well, I'm praying three times a day. It might be a total of 3 minutes all day long. They're short little 1 minute prayers, but you know what? The Lord knows, the Lord understands. But how many hours do we spend scrolling on Facebook and Instagram and TikTok and all that other stuff? How many hours do we spend staring mindlessly into a television set because my stories are off? Because it's the LA law is coming back on it, you know? And I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with that. I got some favorite television programs that I watch too. But what's eating up our time? How diligently are we seeking the Lord? You know, if the Bible says he's a rewarder of those, hey, preacher, speak a little bit louder. I can't hear back here in the back pew. I thought you said he's a rewarder of those. I want to be one that's rewarded. Okay, I'll speak a little bit louder and a little bit clearer so that everyone can hear it. If you want to be rewarded, the biblical standard says you must seek him diligently.
Amen.
He's got to have that importance. You got to wake up in the morning thinking about Jesus. You got to go to work in the morning thinking about Jesus. You got to meet people thinking about Jesus. You got to drive home thinking about Jesus. You got to go to bed thinking about Jesus. You need to pray. You need to thank him throughout the course of the day. You don't have to stop your vehicle and kneel down in a ditch and formally go to prayer. Just stay in a constant state of prayer with the Lord. Yeah, you're driving down the road and you avoid an accident. Woo, Jesus, thank you for taking the wheel. That almost turned out bad. You're driving down the road, your belly starts growling. If your wife was sitting in the front seat, which I think was, so maybe you're the wife. If you're the wife, translate what I'm saying into husband. If your spouse, there we go. If your spouse was sitting in the front seat with you while you're driving down the road and your belly starts going, you're going to say, man, babe, I'm hungry. Let's find this place to pull over and get something to eat. Well, guess what? If you're driving down the road and your spouse isn't with you and it's just you and the Lord and your stomach starts going, well, you say, man, Jesus, I'm starting to get a little bit hungry. I'm going to pull this truck over and go get something to eat. You want to know what? Since Jesus already knows, he's going to say, okay, if you go 24 more miles down the road and turn right, you're going to run into a pilot station. They got a sandwich in there. You see what I mean? Just stay in a constant state of grace. Yes. Diligently seek him. Seek him on behalf of your children. Seek him on behalf of your grandchildren. Seek him on behalf of your church. Seek him on behalf of your nation. Whatever's on your heart, whatever's on your mind, seek him diligently. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all things shall be added unto you. And then the last thing I want to point out. Jesus makes the difference because of his power. He makes a difference because of his knowledge. He makes a difference because of his ability. And just look at the difference he made for these men that day. Those that chose to follow him because they believed in him, because he had done miracles and healed the sick, they decided, there's something to this man. And I'm going to follow him. 5,000 of them followed him. Jesus worked a miracle for them that day and fed them. And verse 14 shows me very clearly their heart of belief. Surely this is that prophet. Surely this is the Messiah. Surely this is the Son of God. Surely this is He who should come. Can I ask you a question in closing? What kind of a difference has Jesus made in your life? Is it powerful enough to have changed who you are? Is it powerful enough to cause someone else to follow Jesus because they won't let you have? Folks, you may be the only Bible that some people will ever read. Let it be the true word of God that they see. I feel like I preached my message. Let's rise to our feet. This is one. Every head to be bowed, and I want every eye to be closed. I'm going to ask Brother Mark to come lead us and close us out in a word of prayer.
Father, thank you.
Are our hearts and minds clear? Anyone with a word or testimony, anything you feel needs to be said or done?